The recording has started. So, would someone like to lead in prayer? And then we will go into. Yeah, sure, Sitkenu. Please go ahead.
Father, we come to the throne of grace. We thank you for all the time you have given us. We thank you for the prayer and intercession. Lord, we are going to study about, Lord. We thank you for all the time you have given us, the blessings you are giving us, Lord, the day you have given us. We thank you for whatever the way you bless us, Lord. And whatever the way we are studying, Lord, whatever we are going to study, Lord, let it should be used in our daily lives, Lord. It should be used for the expansion of your kingdom, Lord. Whatever we will study, Lord, whatever ma'am is going to teach us, Lord, we pray for all the students, Lord, what all the for the teacher, all our faculty, Lord, whatever Lord Pastor this, Lord, we pray whatever this APC Bible College is doing us, Lord, in our whatever the seed of your word they are putting in our, they are sowing in our heart, Lord, let it should be used for the expansion of your kingdom, Lord. We thank you for this time, we thank you for this day, Lord, we thank you for this hour we are going to spend in your presence, Lord. Whatever we will be learning, Lord, let it should be abide in our heart, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Sitkenu. Thank you for that prayer. So we will get into today's session. We are talking about ministering, okay? Ministering through prayer. So far, our focus was ourselves and our personal prayer life and how we are going to see that strengthened in God. And we talked about, you know, some of the things that we can do to develop our own personal life with the Lord. And then we saw some aspects which are kind of deeper. So we said travailing in prayer, you know, intercession. We touched on those things. How do we begin to minister to others? Okay, so now what we're going to do is, yes, we are continuing to talk about intercession, which has to do with blessing others, but we will look at a better understanding of what intercession is as a ministry, and what is the right way of us doing this intercessory prayer. Okay, so in the last class, I introduced to you a man called Epaphras. Epaphras was a minister whom Paul trained in Ephesus. And in Ephesus, there were people from many places who had come to get trained, okay, through the teachings of Paul. So Epaphras was one of those people. He was from Colossae. He went back to Colossae. He planted the church there. And we also see Paul addressing, you know, when he writes to the Colossian church, Paul never went there, but he talks about Epaphras, who has been a faithful minister of God, and to the extent that he stayed with Paul when he was under home arrest in Rome. So he mentions this man Epaphras, and you know, he makes these or uses these descriptions. He says, bond servant of Christ, Epaphras. Okay, just a moment. Yeah. Colossians 4 verses 12 and 13. Epaphras, who is one of you, a bond servant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. So that is the explanation or the description that he gives of Epaphras and his ministry. And he says, Paul says about Epaphras that he has great zeal for the Colossians and also for those who live in Laodicea and Hierapolis. So these are all, you know, places which are close by. This shows us that an individual who is not physically present in a given location, you know, that person can continue to minister to the people through prayer. Okay, so apparently Laodicea was from Colossae, it was about 12 miles away, and Hierapolis was about 14 miles away. Okay, yet from a distance, you know, ministry can still be done, and that is the beauty of prayer ministry. We can be so far away, and today we are all connecting globally. Isn't it? So, is it possible to pray for people who are in another country, other, you know, a part of the globe? Most certainly we can do. do that. And Epaphras, specifically, you know, he used to engage in prayer, and that's what we understand here. Now, there is no limit of time or distance or location in intercessory ministry. And usually what happens, you know, when we engage in intercession, how many of us love it? How many of you totally love intercession? Let me hear from you. And if you do love it, why do you like it? Or, you know, let's say, okay, like, okay, I'm using the term like. How many of you like intercessory ministry and why do you like it? Okay, Subhashish is saying yes. So why do you like it, Subhashish?
It's an opportunity to pray for others, taking their burden and pleading for them before the Lord. And when actually we see the results, then we are thankful to the Lord that because of my prayers, now they are blessed.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing. So we share in the burden, but we also share in the joy when the answer to prayer comes. And, you know, that's what intercession is supposed to be, right? Like, you're serving them, you're standing in the gap on behalf of the person who needs the prayers that we are making. So, yeah. So, Subhashish says that, you know, you can share in the joy, and that's why he likes it. How about the others? Okay, Lubega, it gives me a hard time for sure, but praying for God's grace. Okay, Lubega, that makes two of us. It's not easy for most of us, I'm sure. But thank you for being honest. Many of us struggle, right? It's a lot easier to pray for ourselves, and it's quite difficult to earnestly pray for others. But that's what the Spirit of God produces in us, right? When we see the fruit of the Spirit. It's not for selfishness, but we're led by the Spirit to do what, you know, God wants us to do through our lives. So as part of the fruit of the Spirit is love. We extend that love, we extend that faithfulness towards others, towards God. And in our flesh, we will not be able to do it. Okay, so thanks, Lubega. Very, very honest answer there. So yeah, for many of us, it's not easy to pray for others. Okay, so those of us who like to pray for others, you're engaging in intercessory ministry. Why do you like it? Okay, yes, Rosalind, I can see your hand raised. Please go ahead.
Ma'am, I just want to share like what I do. I just want to know whether it's the right way to do, because normally whenever any request, if it has to be to like pray for somebody, like I'll just place the request before God, and then I will ask the Holy Spirit to pray with me, and I'll be like interceding in tongues. So for like, you know, maybe 20 minutes or 15 minutes, like till that burden is off from my spirit. So this is how I do it, ma'am. So is this like right way?
Yeah, sure, Rosalind. Mm-hmm. I think it's fine. It's
in
fine.
Words, like mostly in words, I avoid, but then I go on in the spirit.
Okay.
And then I see the result also.
Okay. Yeah, it's fine, Rosalind. Yes. It's okay. So we could pray in the spirit till we come to a place of experiencing peace in our hearts. So at least then we know that, you know, whatever we have prayed for, God has... Excuse me, everyone, a little bit of sneezing going on over here. So anyway, so we pray till we receive God's peace. And, you know, that way we know that we have prayed through, to the extent that God wanted us to. And as Paul wrote, right, I pray with my I pray in the spirit, I pray with my understanding, I sing with my spirit, I sing with my understanding. So yes, Rosalind, there's nothing wrong with praying in tongues, but we can also pray with words, okay, as led by God. God might put certain words in our hearts, and we can pray with the words also. Yeah?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Thank you. And here in the comments, Brother Abdesh says, scripture says that if you are blessing anybody, you will also be blessed. Okay, great. So that's another motivation. So when I'm praying for someone, God will bless me. So ultimately, it comes back to me, isn't it? Yeah, that's true. But indeed, to have that heart for intercession, we really have to put God first and put others before us. Then Divya, intercession helps in building faith too for myself and the person we are praying for. Okay, great. Yeah, sure. So it helps build our faith. So these are all some positive reasons why we would like to engage in intercession for others. Okay, and as I told you, it may come easy when we are praying for family members or people who are close to us. But when we pray for things which do not directly affect us, okay, Holy Spirit is telling us to pray, but those things are not directly connected to us, it may be somewhat challenging, at least in the beginning, because we are not able to see the direct impact of it. But the key is to be led by the Spirit, to be aligned to what the Holy Spirit is telling us to do when we are in our prayer time. Now, having said all this, you know, intercession, the motivation to intercede, it's not always, how do I put it? You know, most people are not motivated, because if you ask about preaching, okay, and let's say there is an opportunity to preach and there are 10 believers or 10 leaders with us, and tell them, who wants to preach? Everybody's hands will go up. Maybe because, I don't know, it could also be that, you know, it's more like a ministry where you do it and there is some validation, there is some appreciation, right, that one might receive after they have preached. Or let's say you sing, you lead worship, some validation, you sang well, you ministered well, we could experience the presence of God. It's, you know, in one sense, it feels rewarding. But what about intercession? You know, quietly one goes and they pray. It might feel like, not that it's going unrecognized, because it's being recognized by God, but before people, right? It might feel like nobody knows, you know, I can keep praying like this. What is the use? You know, who knows that I'm an intercessor? So, you know, these kind of thoughts can also get us. But the key thing is that we must do what God is calling us to do. And when God is calling us to intercede for others, and I told you in the last class, we're talking about Epaphras, not just because he was a believer who was interceding, but he was carrying that call of an intercessory ministry. You know, so there is a greater grace to minister. That is his area where God wants him to serve in intercessory prayer. So it's a ministry that God is calling him to do. So we are not just talking about little bit of intercession that we may do in our personal lives. This is more. This is intercession as a ministry. Now, Epaphras is a person who was interceding for people in Colossae, in Hierapolis, in Laodicea as a ministry. Okay, so that was his core ministry. And And though such a ministry, you know, we might think that there's no recognition from men, it's very important when we are called to intercessory ministry to recognize that our appreciation, our validation, right, our answers to prayer, it comes from God. So God is watching us. God is listening to us. God will take notice. God will reward. But that faith one must carry, especially the person who is engaging in intercessory ministry. Now, we also touched on few other things in the last class. We said, based on the introduction of Paul, of Epaphras, we realized that he was not just an ordinary man. You know how we might say, he's an intercessor. You know, in a very normal way, as if to say that it's nothing. There's nothing special about someone who is engaging in intercessory ministry. No, Paul didn't speak about Epaphras like that. Instead, he said, he's a bond servant. And I told you in the last class, bond servant has to do, he generally used that term as a term which was also used for apostles or ministers of God. So that same seriousness, that same honor, that same, affirmation is given to somebody in the intercessory ministry. Okay, so is an intercessor somewhat low, whom we don't equate with others who may be preaching or planting churches and doing other wonderful things? Not at all. In fact, it's very similar. No wonder Paul is calling that person also a bond servant who is serving through prayer ministry. Then he says, laboring fervently. Now, laboring fervently, again, is applicable to every other ministry. Now, if you take a teacher of the word, you know, there's diligent study of the word, rightly dividing the word of God, then imparting the word of God with the anointing. So laboring fervently comes into the picture. Paul uses the same, way of describing an intercessor, somebody who is laboring fervently. So a true intercessor, somebody who's carrying that call and that anointing, they don't pray, like quick fix prayers and call it intercession. Yeah, over, finished. No, but they are engaging. It's like warfare, right? They continue to pray. They don't stop. Maybe God has put somebody on their hearts and, God wants this person to pray. And I know of people who pray for others, for months, for years, or several times till they see something happen in that individual's life. So laboring fervently, which is talked about for other ministries, it's also talked about for intercessory prayer. So a true intercessor will put in the effort, put in the work, have that heart to see the results when they engage in prayer. So laboring fervently to see the results. In other words, it's not a casual ministry. Okay, I'll pray. If God works, let him work. If he doesn't work, it's okay. Not that kind of an attitude. Then we find Paul also used terms like perfect and complete. Okay, so Epaphras is laboring fervently so that the believers can become perfect and complete. Now, perfection and completion is maturity. If you take, for example, teaching ministry, the teachers teach, or if you take all the fivefold ministry offices, why are they laboring? In Ephesians 4:13, we see that so that people come to perfection, or they grow up in God, they come to maturity in God, become a perfect man, it says. So similar to the fivefold ministry and what each one is engaging in, the goal is the same even for intercessory prayer one. When we pray, we can truly see such a result in the lives of the believers, that they grow into maturity, right? So through intercession, one can invest in praying for people's maturity. And then, you know, there is great zeal that Paul talks about in the life of Epaphras, in the ministry of Epaphras. Intercessory prayer, we just discussed and we said it doesn't come easy to most of us. And think about Epaphras, you know, a lot of praying going on in his life. Was he excited about it? From what Paul is writing, yes. Great zeal or passionate. He was very, very passionate about prayer and intercession for the people. So, you know, it gives us a new way of looking at somebody who's graced with intercessory ministry. They are not just ordinary, or they are not, you know, second class ministers, or they are not, unrecognized ministers. They are very much like all the other ministers who are serving, you know, as pastors, as teachers, as prophets, as, you know, in their different capacities. So we should not look down on the ministry of intercession. Okay, that's the whole point that we were trying to make. And one must be excited about the opportunity to minister through intercession. Okay, so are we good so far? Any thoughts, any questions at this point? Okay. Yeah, Roslyn, please go ahead.
No, I said we're fine.
You're fine. Okay, yeah. Good. I was just looking at the comments here, and Divya was saying sometimes intercession, it can become a kind of a routine, and it can be very challenging. And Roslyn says intercession is mostly behind the scenes. Okay. All right. Yeah, it's true. We have to press through, right? What we said, laboring fervently, I think even laboring through the monotony sometimes is necessary. Okay, yeah, Divya, please go ahead. You have something to share?
Sorry, Pastor Nancy, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so I had this question regarding here, since we are talking about Epaphras, intercession, is it in the context of, you know, praying for a congregation, or is it like those individual, you know, prayers that we make for individuals also taken into account?
Yes, Divya, thank you for that. So, see, what we are trying to say is, now, for example, if you take prophecy, okay, believers prophesying, I'm giving you a completely different parallel, okay, just for understanding sake. Believers prophesying is like using the gift of prophecy, okay, through the Holy Spirit. But when we talk about somebody who has a prophetic ministry, it's more than an ordinary believer who is the person with the prophetic ministry has the grace. So we generally say like grace gift of ministry, grace gift of prophecy. So the person has, you know, the prophetic going on in whatever they do. Okay, so it's like a prophesying believer, I'm just giving you for your understanding, prophesying believer, grace gift of prophecy. And then we talk about office, prophetic office. Now, somebody who's functioning at a very higher authority in that same anointing. Okay, so there's a difference. So far, we have understood what intercession is. Intercession is just going to God on behalf of somebody else. So, normal intercession, we pray for others. That's okay. But ministering through prayer, the context in which I'm teaching you is more like somebody who has that grace to be an intercessor. You know what I mean? All of us are intercessors, but there are some who are called for that, who have the grace to do that. Okay, so yeah, so that's how we are looking at you know, what I'm teaching today, Divya. Does it make sense?
Yeah, sure, Pastor. Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah, so I was trying to understand, like, how would anyone know that they are called to a ministry of intercession or not?
Yeah. I think the way one could know, Divya, is, you know, generally, it's like you just get started on it. And then you will see, you know, God affirming it as you go along. You'll have more opportunities. You'll just find that you have more grace to do that. Okay. So basically, you step into it and then it becomes better and stronger. And then you realize, oh, wow, I'm called for this.
Sure. Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah, sure, Divya. So that's the way in which we can also discover it. But talking about intercessory prayer and ministry of intercession, you know, we said it's definitely an important ministry. We should not think that, you know, this is a second class ministry just because you don't have intercessors out there, right? In the open, praying before us. Yeah, right. So Rosalyn says, burden for others will draw us to intercede. That's right. Yeah. So just because the intercessory minister or the intercessor is not out there in the open, how can we keep ourselves motivated? You know, Jesus taught us this. He said that when we go and we go behind closed doors, right? And we pray, we shut the door and pray, Matthew 6 verses 5 and 6. But when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Okay, so here is our motivation. When we are behind closed doors, or in other words, nobody notices what we are doing, our heart has to be confident in the fact that God who sees us will reward us openly. So in secret, we are investing in intercessory prayer, intercessory ministry. But how does the reward for that come? Openly. So that is why we always say, you know, time in prayer, whether it is intercession or whether it is personal prayer or whatever, time spent in prayer is never wasted. Why? Because it's like an investment. We pray, God sees us in secret, and then he rewards us openly. So that should be a great motivation for those of us who are called to the ministry of intercession, or if not ministry of intercession, even ministry, even intercession in general. We should be happy that God hears us and God will reward us. Now, the other thing that will encourage us when we think about intercession is that, you know, our prayers, they go like sacrifice, incense before the Lord. You know, if you look back at the temple worship, they had incense. Okay, incense would go up and it would fill the place. And that is something God had asked for, fragrance, right? But we are told, like Psalm 141 verse 2 here, it says, let my prayer be set before you as an incense. So our prayer, in other words, it is pleasing to God. Now we might think, how much will God hear my prayer? Won't he get bored? Okay. Or won't he be tired of hearing these prayers? Instead, what the Bible teaches us is that God is pleased. Whenever sincere prayer comes before him, it is like incense. It is like fragrance. It makes God happy. It's like the evening sacrifice. Revelation 5 and verse 8, you know, that again tells us the same thing. There are, in God's presence, there are bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. So our prayers are directly reaching the presence of God. Okay, think about that. What a great opportunity. What a great privilege. So anytime as an intercessor, we feel that, what is this? Nobody knows. It's so tedious to concentrate and pray for others. Okay. I don't know if this is of any use. We can remind ourselves of all these things. When we pray in secret, God will reward us openly. My prayer is like incense in the presence of the Lord. It is like evening sacrifice, right? And my prayers go directly into the presence of God. So we can be assured that our time, our energy, our effort of praying for others will never be wasted. And that should be motivation enough for us to engage in intercessory prayer. And this is a ministry. Okay, intercession is a ministry. What is a ministry? When we say something is a ministry, what do we mean by that? Anyone? Intercession is a ministry. So what is the meaning of that?
A service.
Madam, can I share?
Service. Okay. Yes, Divya, and yes, Elisha, please go ahead.
Yeah, it is meeting the serving to meet the needs of people.
Thank you. So you're saying ministry means to meet the needs of people, is it?
Yes, yes, please.
Okay, great, great, great. Wonderful. So service and meeting the needs of people. That's true. Intercession is a service. Okay. And we are here, every ministry that we do, it's not, you know, yes, we are blessed. Personally, we are blessed when we serve others. But the main focus is others. The main focus is we are building up people in the body of Christ. And thus, you know, we are serving the Lord himself. So this is a, intercession is a ministry where we have the opportunity to serve others. Now, we may not meet them. We may not even know them, but we can still bless them. We can serve them through the prayers that we pray for them. And the privilege of intercessory prayer is this, that we can engage in this anywhere, anytime. Okay, anywhere, anytime. So we can talk about some instructions that will be helpful for engaging in intercessory prayer. Now, God calls us to pray. You know, one challenge I told you is feeling unrecognized. Okay. Now, to compensate for that, it can so happen that we want to go and tell everybody, right, that I am an intercessor and, you know, God put this on my heart and I prayed and it happened like this, or I prayed and it did not happen like this. So what we see in scriptures, we don't see people doing that. In fact, we just saw how Jesus said, go and pray in secret and I will reward you in open. So though it is hard, an intercessor, it is good if they don't try to, you know, go around sharing all these details with others. And if it is with the intention of promoting oneself, okay, and this can happen in every ministry, not just in intercession, it's not required. No, we just trust that if God has called us to do this ministry and he is equipping us, surely there will be a result. And if God wants others to know that, hey, this person is called to intercessory prayer, then others will know. You will come to that place of being recognized. But we don't try to promote ourselves by letting everybody know that, hey, you know, I'm an intercessor, I'm an intercessor. Not required. Okay. Then when it comes to, you know, intercession, we trust that, you know, we are doing it to serve the people. Okay, so it should again not be used as something like, how do I say this? You know, depending on the issues. For example, let's say a pastor. Okay, and a pastor, he decides, he or she decides that I don't want to construct a building for my church. And there are some intercessors in the church who are praying, and they get a revelation that, okay, you know, there's going to be a church building constructed by the congregation. So they start praying for that. Now, it would be totally wrong if the intercessors try to pressure, or they try to, I mean, they may or may not know that it's manipulation, but, you know, they try to push the pastor and say, you have to decide to start construction right away because that's what God told us. That's what we are praying for. And you have to do it. Right? But ultimately, it's the pastor's decision. If the pastor says, no, I don't want to get into construction right now because we don't have the money, or, okay, you heard from God, but I have not yet heard from God, you know, things like that. It's okay. It's okay. So the duty of the intercessor is to, if God has revealed something to us, we have to pray that through, right? Faithfully. We are not here to push people around based on what has been revealed to us and what we are praying for others. Okay, so it shouldn't be used as something to pressure people. That's the point I'm making. Okay, and it is very much possible through intercessory ministry. It's very much possible to do this to others, but we must be careful. Let's say God reveals something very important to us, okay, and we are praying about it. The good thing to do would be to keep it to yourself and continue praying for it, right? Most of the time, I told you this when we did prophetic prayer. Most of the time, God reveals something for us to pray through, not necessarily go and tell everybody about it. When we start praying about it, you know, if God gives a specific instruction and says, I want you to go and share this with so and so, or I want you to stand up and share this, you know, with your life group or with your congregation, and of course, with the pastor's permission, you are free to do that. But most revelation that we receive, it is good to simply pray it through. Okay, so these are some instructions that will help us pray in such a way that we are not promoting ourselves, we are not using this ministry to pressure others, you know, and try to direct others the way we want them to go. But instead, we are using this ministry to serve others. So the good part is that when we pray for others, you know, we can receive the peace of God in our hearts that we have done our part to bless them, right? So in some cases, you and I might see the results. For example, if let's say a parent, they have prayed for their child for many years and they want to, God has told them that they will be, that he will be working through that child in a certain way in the ministry. And this parent has prayed all along for many years. And for whatever reason, you know, the parent is not alive when this child actually steps into the ministry. The parent is not there to see that the child is actually now, you know, moving in the things that he or she prayed for. So in some instances, the intercessor may not get to see what they prayed for. It is reward enough to be in the presence of God. It's reward enough to pray through those prayers. It's reward enough to receive the joy and the assurance, you know, of God when we pray for that individual. It's you know, joyful to see that person making the journey and God working in that person's life. So what I'm saying is we may not see the end result. Now, even if you take something like praying for a nation or something like praying for a region or a city, there are people who have prayed for years, they've prayed for decades, they've prayed for revival for, I don't know, centuries. right? But they may not have seen the results. However, one thing we know, every prayer session, we receive the peace of God. We receive the joy of God. You know, we are touched by the presence of God. And we stand in assurance. Okay, we have prayed. We believe that in the spiritual realm, God is doing something. So by His Spirit, He is able to give us that assurance. Now, in some instances, yes, as some of you pointed out, we hear the testimony. You prayed for that sick person. That person is now out of the hospital. Or you prayed, that person did not have money to pay their fees. Now they paid their fees. A miracle happened. So we are able to rejoice with the results that we see. But in many instances, we may not see immediate results. Okay, and yet we can still walk in joy and peace and the presence of God as intercessors, trusting that God is working, right? And God has His own timing of doing things in the lives of people. Now, as some of you pointed out, another good motivation for us is that when we pray for others, God is so faithful that He will release blessings on our lives. Okay, so there is a passage here from Job 42 and verse 10. Would somebody like to read this, please? It's on page 52, end of the page, Job 42 and verse 10.
Job 42 verse 10. Yes. And the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before.
Wow, thank you, Divya. So comforting and so encouraging. Couple of things we notice here is Job is interceding. He's praying for his friends. Okay. That itself brings him of what he had lost. But in this particular incident, Job is also praying for those who betrayed him, in a sense, isn't it? He expected a lot more support from his friends when he was going through a difficult time. And these people were not supportive at all. On the other hand, their words were breaking his spirit. So, Job is praying, that is one thing. But second thing here is, he's also walking in forgiveness. Very hard, very, very hard. Based on what he has been through, he's blessing those who did not bless him in his difficult time. But this is what God is showing us. He's saying, look, the reward comes from me. I am your rewarder. If you walk in the right path, and in this case, forgiveness and blessing, you know, those who you bless those who persecute you, right? You pray for those who speak evil things against you. God will bless us back. And God tells us that, you know, when we pray for others, surely our lives will also be blessed. Okay. God doesn't forget us as individuals and say, okay, you forget about yourself. You only pray for others. No, but He's so sensitive, so thoughtful, our God, that He says, okay, you are praying for others. You are ministering to others. I'm also a God. I know how to bless you. And in this case, when Job prayed for his friends, he received twice of what he had lost. So at this point, I'm just going to pause. And maybe we can discuss any other thoughts about intercession, any questions that you might have. We can try to answer them.
Pastor Nancy, I just had something. It's not related to this topic.
Okay.
It's related to prayer. So I was having a conversation with one of my friends, and she was talking about prayer language and praying in tongues. So I just wanted to, I got a little confused with these two terms. So are they the same? And can you also help me with Romans 8, 26 to 27, where it says, the Spirit intercedes in, thank you.
So Divya, prayer language, okay, generally it is used for tongues. Many people use that. They say tongues is a prayer language. It's a God-given prayer language. So it's just a way of identifying, praying in the Spirit. So what confused you? What exactly confused you about that?
So this is Romans 8, 26 and 27. So this particular reference, so since according to what I've been taught, like even in the Bible college, I have understood it as, the praying in tongues, right? It is referring to
the Spirit.
So there was some term like in NKJV, I think it's wordless groans, it says, and I'm not sure if it is NKJV. There was is it the tongues really, you're uttering sounds, or it's wordless, right? So my friend is saying in your heart, like in your spirit, you're praying. It's not related to tongues. So I got a bit confused with that. So even I was, I was just.
Yeah, sure. I get your point, Divya. So yes, tongues is a language. And Romans 8, 26 and 27, I think we have talked in this class only about it, where you have the Spirit of God coming alongside you, right? So he comes alongside, he takes a hold of you, he empowers you to pray in the will of God for his purposes. Now, yes, some translations you see that, what your friend mentioned, groaning, sighs and groans. It's part of the language, Divya. It's part of the language, okay? And that doesn't mean, sighs and groans doesn't mean it's empty. There is some communication of the Spirit that shows up as sighs and groans. Now, just a simple thing that I have experienced in my life. This was a family who are from a different background, okay, for many, many years. And this one uncle, he never believed, even though his wife is a believer. And, they came to church, and it was one of those Sundays where we were praying for the Holy Spirit baptism. And we prayed for, this person and many other people. While others were speaking in languages, this individual, what we are saying, groaning, sighing, and then, he at one point he was weeping like a baby. That was the manifestation which we saw as compared to the languages which others were speaking. I mean, in my experience, I've usually seen, baptism of the Holy Spirit, they start saying something like ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, something like that. But for the first time, I'm looking at this person, and I'm sure he can't be faking it, because he's like this grown man who for a long time resisted God's word, but finally he accepted and he came for Holy Spirit baptism. And, he would, in the natural, he would be embarrassed to sigh and groan and weep like that. But it was happening in front of our eyes. So for me, I took a lesson from that, and I thought, oh yeah, this sounds like what Romans 8, 26, 27 says. But the release of that language, that heavenly language, was in this form. So it's part of the language, is what I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got it.
Okay.
See, for us, it doesn't entail anything. I'm just going like, or something. But how do I know what it means in the spirit to God, what I'm saying?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
So, see, one syllable can mean so much, but we can't understand all that. We just have to trust what the word says. When we speak in an unknown tongue, we speak mysteries unto God. You know, we pray in the will of God. We should have faith. Huh? That's exactly what's happening right now. I'm praying in the will of God. I'm speaking mysteries unto God. I'm going to receive the blessings from God.
Yeah, it's clear. Thank you.
Sure, Divya, sure. And I think Rosalind is also adding to that here in the chat. She's saying groaning is utterance in the spirit, but spoken language by a believer. Only the Holy Spirit knows. Yeah, sure. So, yes, class, I think we have gone a little past our time. But I would still encourage you to think about intercession and tomorrow's class. Let's start with some questions on intercession and then we will proceed on to the next topic. Okay, so at the moment, we are going to wrap up with a word of prayer. And just want to encourage, how about Jeffina? Jeffina, you want to pray so we can close today? Okay, not sure if she's able to pray. Elisha, are you okay to pray? Okay, anyone then?
Can I pray?
Yeah, Divya, please go for it.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for all that, Father, you're teaching us, Lord. Thank you, Father, for you revealing us, Lord, what the Holy Spirit has inspired in your word, Father, Lord, what we can learn, Father, from the life of people, Lord, in the Bible. Yes, Father, Lord, we thank you and praise you, Father, for your reward is with us, Father, Lord, and it is not for, Lord, our self-exaltation or anything, Father, that any ministry is done. Yes, Lord, our reward is with you, and you thank you, Lord, that you speak to us that it is more blessed to give than to receive. Yes, Lord, thank you and praise you that our standard is Jesus Christ. Thank you that you showed us that the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. We thank you and praise you, Lord, for all the equipping, Father, of the Holy Spirit that you have provided, Father, Lord, so as to edify each other, Father, Lord, and all that you've given us to edify ourselves as well, Father, Lord. We thank you and praise you for every blessing, Lord. Thank you for Pastor Nancy, Father, Lord. Continue to bless her, Lord. We pray for a complete recovery, Lord, from all the cold, Father, Lord. I pray your complete recovery over her, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We thank and praise you for each and every student, Father, Lord. Thank you, Father, for ministering to us, Father. Thank you, Lord, for helping us, Lord. We trust, Father, that in the coming days, Lord, we will, Lord, apply, Father, and move, Father, explore in these areas, Father, in these ministries, Father, Lord. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' precious name. We pray.
Amen. And thank you. Thank you, Divya. Thank you for praying for me also. God bless. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. God bless you. Have a wonderful day, and we shall meet tomorrow again. Okay, so see you tomorrow. Bye.
Hi, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, brother. Bye. God bless. Thank you, everyone.